Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stuka Attack, the dive bombing assault on England during the Battle of Britain, by Andy Saunders. Narrated by John Lee. Introduction. Some may argue, perhaps, that overuse of the word iconic has rather devalued its significance in the English language. Too often we are told that some object or another, or some event or venue is iconic, a description that is also quite frequently applied to famous weapons of World War II. In some cases, the word has been used in association with weapons that are perhaps rather more infamous than famous, and such could probably be said of the much-feared Junkers 87 Stuka dive bomber, although if any one weapon of the period should be described as iconic, then surely this is it. Strictly speaking, the word Stuka could be applied to any Luftwaffe aircraft employed in a dive bombing capacity, including the Junkers 88, and some variants of the Messerschmitt 110. The name Stuka is, though, just a shortened version of the German word Sturzkampfflugzeug, or dive bomber aircraft. However, despite the fact that it is a name that could be applied to other aircraft types, it has become the exclusive moniker of the Junkers 87. Universally and exclusively known as the Stuka. As a weapon of World War II, there can be no doubting its fame and notoriety, and it is readily and universally recognized with its angular lines and distinctive, inverted, and oddly cranked gull-wing configuration. Not surprisingly, its fixed undercarriage helped give rise to the notion that it was somehow predatory. It was certainly the case that, in its death-dealing dives, it looked remarkably like a bird of prey as it swooped down onto a helpless quarry. Certainly, it had swept through Europe from Poland to Norway and on into the Blitzkrieg across France and the Low Countries. Its reputation had been fearsome, its success undoubted. For the most part, it was very much at the spearhead of assault, taking out armor, bridges, troop concentrations, and other pinpoint targets. Weaknesses and failings had, however, manifested themselves in the aircraft's early deployment, and these would ultimately be exploited by those engaged in the interception of Stuka raids. Nevertheless, the aircraft was used through to the war's end, in every theatre of operations, and to considerable effect. It is its specific use during the Battle of Britain, however, that is the focus of this book. Once the Stuka Geschwadern were established in France on the English Channel coast during the early summer of 1940, they faced not only the hazards of a two-way sea crossing, but, for the first time, opposition from a well-organized air defense force and its integrated command and control structure. If the campaigns in the West had, until now, been a comparative walkover for the Stuka force, then things would be very different over England and the Channel. Not by any means, though, did the defenders always have it all their own way. But, more often than not, the Stuka would be embroiled in the bitterest of fighting. Frequently, losses were high. On the other hand, however, successes were considerable, if not somewhat mixed, and it is frequently suggested that the Stuka force was eventually withdrawn from frontline service against England because of unacceptable attrition rates being suffered by mid-August 1940. But was this actually the case? In this book, I have examined in detail the history of most of the significant Junkers 87 Stuka operations against British targets between July 1940 and February 1941, looking at the specifics of those attacks by drawing on the experiences of participants, defenders, and eyewitnesses. Losses and successes relating to those attacks are examined, and I have utilized contemporary official documentation from both sides in order to analyze the Stuka's overall role in that campaign. Never before has a specific account of the Luftwaffe's Junkers 87 assault against the British Isles been comprehensively told in one volume. The story of the Stuka's dramatic deployment is an important and uniquely fascinating aspect of Battle of Britain history. This is that story. Andy Saunders, East Sussex, May 2013. Chapter 1. First Encounters. The outstanding success of the Polish campaign was the successful use of the Junkers 87 dive bomber, With little or no opposition to hamper them, the units equipped with this aircraft were able to exploit the accuracy of bomb aiming inherent in the steep dive, as well as the demoralizing effect on personnel exposed to dive bombing attacks. Air Ministry, 1948. The Rise and Fall of the German Air Force, 1933-1945. It was still dark during the early hours of the 1st of September 1939 when Stuka pilot Feldwebel Heinz Rockstechel sat down for the briefing of 3 Stuka Geschwader 2, just prior to the opening shots of World War II. Although he did not take part in the very first Stuka mission of the day, flown at 4:42 by 1 Stuka Geschwader 1 against bridges over the Vistula River near Dirschau, Rockstechel and his radio operator, Oberfeldwebel Willy Witt, were amongst the very first Junkers 87 Stuka crews to fly an operational sortie when they took off with the rest of 1st Gruppe for their targets. For 1 and 2 Staffel, this would be the airfield at Krakow, whilst Rockstechel's 3rd Staffel were assigned other targets close to the Polish-German border. It must have been with a degree of nervous excitement that the pair pulled on their flying overalls that morning. However, this was what they had trained for over many months. Now they were flying off to make history in an aircraft type that would see service from the very first to the very last day of the war. Rockstechel and his comrade, however, would not see the end of that war, although the sortie flown on the 1st of September 1939 was the very first of 76 operational flights they would make together. The next such mission was on the 2nd of September, when 2 Gruppe were assigned Piotrków Railway Station. Here, a division of Polish infantry were detraining, and 40 Stukas from Stuka Geschwader 2 and Stuka Geschwader 76 wiped them out. And so, with an almost regular repetition, the combat flights against Poland continued right up until the end of that brief campaign on the 30th of September. As the Air Ministry observed in 1948, the outstanding success of that campaign had been the Stuka, and there can be little doubt that it also hastened the rapid achievement of total military superiority and victory in Poland. There was no reason to suppose that the pattern would not be repeated, once Britain and her allies declared war on Germany on the 3rd of September 1939, and Rockstechel and Witt probably had little doubt they would soon be thrown against these new enemies. The near invincibility of the Stuka and its awesome capabilities had been ably demonstrated, and the Stuka men must have been buoyed up with confidence. That confidence, though, was described by RAF intelligence officer, Flying Officer S. John Pescott, who would later interview a captured Stuka pilot in France as sheer and unadulterated superior arrogance of a most unsavory kind. At this stage of the war, however, there was certainly some good reason for the Stuka men to feel confident, and Pescott later went on to describe the Stuka's successes across France by quoting Milton, "With ruin upon ruin, rout on rout, confusion worse confounded." With the Polish campaign over, there remained very little for the Stuka crews to do, apart from enter a period of intensive training, in anticipation of an assault on the West that would surely come. On periods of home leave, though, the Stuka crews were treated as conquering heroes by a German public whose propaganda-stoked adulation knew almost no bounds. As one Stuka pilot said, "We were no less than gods in their eyes." For Heinz Rockstechel and his faithful radio operator, the assault on the West opened on the 10th of May 1940 with no less than 7 sorties flown by them from their base at Kotzheim that day. It was a punishing schedule which had begun with a dive bombing attack against Eben Emael. Here, the crucial fort overlooking the Albert Canal was seized from Belgian forces by German airborne troops, and the supporting attacks by Stukas against precise targets required absolute precision. Rockstechel noted that his target was Fort Entrance, and a pilot from another Stuka unit operating against the fort pointed out, "The operation against such a pinpoint target in a very limited area, right next to previously landed gliders and paratroopers, did not only call for accuracy, but our crews carried a heavy responsibility to our comrades on the ground and the success of the whole offensive." Certainly the operation was a success, and with Stuka support, the fortress at Ebenemail was taken in an operation that saw Rochtechel and Witt flying 3 sorties against the fort that day, once with a 500-kilogram bomb and twice with a 250-kilogram bomb. Later that same day, and flying T-6 and KL throughout, the pair attacked troops at Ebenrimst and Wellingen, a bridge at Bessingen, and the airfield at Saint-Trond, where the destruction of 12 aircraft was noted. Another Stuka pilot taking part on the 10th of May 1940 was Oberleutnant Helmut Malka, then flying with 2 Tragerstuka Gruppe 186, later redesignated 3 Stuka Geschwader 1, as part of the opening salvo of the Blitzkrieg in an attack on Metz Frescati airfield. Malka takes up the story. "We took off from our base at Hemweiler, near Trier, in complete darkness at 0508 hours. I was flying Junkers 87, J9 and KK, and we were led by our Gruppe commander, Major Walter Hagen. We had quite a lot of difficulty assembling in the dark with a full Gruppe of 30 aircraft, but for takeoff and assembly we had our navigation lights on and took off singly because of the dark. Once we were formed up, it was lights out, and we flew on to our target in the growing dawn light. We flew at 3,500 meters, which was the highest we could fly without oxygen. On the way, it was radio silence. The leader waggling his wings meant close up, and an undulating flight meant open out. We didn't have a fighter escort because the fighters had gone on ahead in Freijagd patrols to sweep the sky, and so we knew we shouldn't encounter any problems. We also knew that the French had no early warning system, and so they couldn't tell we were coming. All of our Junker 87s taking part in this attack had their sirens removed beforehand, since we didn't want to advertise our arrival. We had some difficulty finding the target, but suddenly I spotted it. It was almost exactly at 90 degrees on the port side. So the leader ordered us into Gefechtsreihe formation, line astern. Suddenly all 30 Stukas are strung out in a row, as we did a 3/4 of a circle turn. This would position us so as to let us attack from the east and directly into the wind. As we lined up for our dives, the French flak opened up from below. But their shooting was very slow, and it didn't bother us very much. The target assigned to my Ketta, 3 aircraft group, was the old airship hangar, and during the maneuver I could see this clearly. When it was my turn, I followed the others into a bank, which I then pushed into an 80-degree dive, and then let go with a salvo of my 5 bombs at about 700 meters. I had 1 250-kilogram bomb and 4 50-kilogram bombs. I then swung over to one side and began my pullout. As I did so, I looked round at the target, and at first it seemed like nothing had happened. The huge hangar was still there. Our bombs had not gone off. Then it seemed as if the whole place was expanding, as though somebody was blowing up a toy balloon, before the whole thing collapsed inwards in a cloud of smoke and debris. Our job done, we turned about and returned to an airfield at Ferschweiler, but we were not on the ground for very long. Over the next month, we were worked to exhaustion, flying long hours and making several battle sorties each day if the weather was favorable for dive bombing operations. There followed for the Stuka force a hectic pace of activity over the coming month as German forces raced up through France and the Low Countries to the Channel coast and through the Netherlands to the North Sea. As the advance moved forward, so the Stuka units were leapfrogging northwards, sometimes operating from French airfields that had been overrun, and other times from suitably large pastures and fields. For Rochtechel and Witt, still flying their trusty T-6 and KL, a move up to Beaulieu via Libine took place on the 21st of May. But Heinz's diary entries illustrate the speed of events. Courtil-Normand against troops, 3 times, on the 15th of May, an attack on a railway station and armored train at Soissons on the 18th, an attack on destroyers at Boulogne on the 23rd, 3 times, and then against ships at Dunkirk and Nieuport on the 29th of May. These are just a small selection of the missions being flown daily, and often up to 4 combat operations each day with Lyon, Château-Thierry, and Cherbourg East being some of the bases used. Through France, of course, the Stuka force began to encounter often determined opposition from the hard-fighting French Air Force units and RAF hurricane squadrons, but this was often sporadic and disorganized. In part, this may well have been due to the lack of any proper command and control structure for the defenders, and with considerable reliance placed upon sightings of formations from either airborne patrols or from the ground. Then, of course, the problem existed of getting fighters off the ground and into position, and in doing so, quickly enough. However, when fighters did engage with the Stuka force, the claims and the dive bomber casualties started to mount, and their aircrew began to realize that mixing it with high-performance fighters was no picnic when flying the Junkers 87. Quite likely, the first RAF squadrons to engage in France with the Junkers 87 were the Hurricane-equipped 87 and 607 squadrons on the 11th of May, with both units making multiple claims against Stukas of Stuka Geschwader II, the Geschwader losing 8 aircraft, with 4 damaged. Unfortunately, the detailed records of 87 squadron were lost during the French campaign and, ironically, one of the squadron pilots, pilot officer John Cock, noted, "I think they all went up in smoke during a Stuka attack." Other squadrons too were having some success against the Junkers 87 in France, and Flying Officer Derek Allen, DFC, achieved ace status, 5 destroyed, with a Stuka he shot down on the 15th of May over Ernage. His claim is likely to have been the machine of 9 Stuka Geschwader II, which crashed near the village of Saart, killing Unteroffizier Urban and Obergefreiter Brandt, although no trace of Fritz Urban was ever found. Already, the vulnerability of the Stuka to RAF fighter aircraft was being painfully demonstrated, with what had hitherto been its reputation of battlefield invincibility being severely dented. As Oberleutnant Otto Schmidt of 3 Stuka Geschwader 77 remarked, "By the end of the first day of the campaign in the West, my Staffel had lost a third of its crews. It was a painful reminder to them that this wasn't Poland." It is not the intention or purpose of this book to attempt anything like a comprehensive account of the part played by the Stuka in air campaigns before the 1940 assault against Britain. That has already been done successfully and more ably by others, although it is necessary in the context of this book to set the scene for an examination of the almost legendary part played later by the Junkers 87 in the Battle of Britain. Of course, apart from Poland and France, at least some passing mention must be made of the role of the Stuka in the campaign in Norway and in the air actions over Dunkirk. In Norway, one Stuka Geschwader I, with their longer-range and drop-tank-equipped Junkers 87R aircraft, had been employed to hasten the German victory, and once again they proved their worth against specific targets, and especially ships in the narrow fjords. On the 30th of April, the sloop, HMS Bittern, had her stern all but blown off at Namsos, and with her steering gear gone, she had to be sent to the bottom by a torpedo from HMS Juno. It was the first bitter lesson for the Royal Navy in terms of the vulnerability of its ships to dive-bombing attack, and the naval staff at the Admiralty must have been ruefully reflecting on the US Navy's 1920s exercises, using dive-bombers against warships when it was concluded. There was no defense against it. Certainly, hitting a Stuka that was already in its bomb-delivering dive by either flak or fighter was difficult. But there was a defense against the Stuka if fighters could get through to them. And on the 27th of May, Flight Lieutenant Cesar Hull made what was probably the first RAF kill of a Junkers 87. Flying an obsolescent Gloster Gladiator biplane of 263 Squadron, Hull shot down a first Staffel Junkers 87 of Stuka Geschwader I, putting the aircraft into the sea off Bodur, from where its pilot, Feldwebel Zuber, and his radio operator were soon rescued. As will be seen later, it was not the only time the RAF used outdated and outclassed biplanes in an attempt to counter the Junkers 87. The Stukas had caught the Gladiators on the ground, and Hull raced to get airborne and chase them, but he didn't have it all his own way. He tells the story here in his own words. got the gladiator going and shot off without helmet or waiting to do anything up. Circled the drone, climbing, and pinned an 87 at the bottom of its dive. It made off slowly over the sea, and just as I was turning away, another 87 shot up past me, and its shots went through my windscreen, knocking me out for a while. Came to, and was thanking my lucky stars, when I heard a rat-tat behind me and felt my gladiator hit. Went into a right-hand turn and dive, but could not get it out. Had given up all hope at 200 feet when she centralized and I gave her a burst of engine to clear some large rocks. Further rat-tats behind me, so I gave up hope and decided to get her down. Held off, then crashed. In the events running up to the Dunkirk evacuation, the battle for Calais was crucial, and it was also another in which the Stuka played a major role. In fact, the citadel fell on the 26th of May 1940, and its final collapse was certainly aided by several Stuka attacks. Rockteschel and Witt took part in two such attacks that day. The RAF had no such weapon as the Stuka on its inventory, but they must have sincerely wished they had, in order to use them against targets that may have hampered the German advance. It was with a degree of desperation, then, that on the very next day, the RAF committed six Hawker Hectors of 613 Squadron from RAF Limpny to dive-bomb German artillery on the outskirts of Calais. The biplane aircraft were obsolete long before the outbreak of war, and the measure was as desperate as it was futile. Carrying only two 112-pound bombs, the Hectors were outclassed and irrelevant. In any case, Calais had already fallen, but the Hector was the only answer the RAF had. The part played by the Stuka in the events at Dunkirk is, of course, already widely written about. Again, it has been covered in other detailed histories, but suffice to say that during the evacuation of British troops, the Stukas accounted for numerous evacuation ships and an almost intolerable number of British and French naval vessels, amongst them the destroyers Basilisk, Foudroyant, Grenade, Havant, Keith, Ladois, and Mistral, not to mention the havoc and destruction caused amongst the assembling British and French forces around Dunkirk. An almost inestimable number of fatalities must have resulted amongst these armies from Stuka attacks. Interestingly, Oberleutnant Otto Schmidt of Stuka Geschwader 77, who claimed a 2,000 and 3,000-ton ship, observed of the Dunkirk operations, "Over Dunkirk, I was personally more worried about flak from the ships, rather than the British fighters, which caused us little trouble. Personally, I only saw one RAF fighter over Dunkirk, and he did not attempt to attack my Staffel, and our unit suffered no losses over Dunkirk." For Otto Schmidt and others of the Stuka Verbande, it would be a different story over England. Thus far, Heinz Rockteschel and Willy Witt of Stuka Geschwader 2, the Immelmann Geschwader, had survived Poland, France, and Dunkirk, but they were living on borrowed time. Chapter 2. Attack on Portland. Dowding would later decree that the Battle of Britain had not yet begun, but on the 4th of July 1940, the Luftwaffe struck what might be considered its first major blow towards securing air supremacy in the English Channel, with a two-pronged Junkers 87 attack against a convoy off Portland, OA 178, and on the Portland naval base itself. It was to be the costliest blow suffered by British forces at the hands of the Stuka, and was a classic demonstration, if one were ever needed, of the effectiveness of the Junkers dive bomber. Whilst OA 178 was a convoy taking its passage through the English Channel, it was not a Channel convoy per se, at least not of the type that almost weekly plied eastwards and westwards, up and down the Channel, or Stuka Alley, as the mariners appropriately dubbed it. This, instead, was an outbound Atlantic convoy numbered 178, hence OA. These convoys were escorted to the western approaches, where the ships then dispersed for their onward voyages, although the OA convoys were rerouted immediately after this attack when they were sailed northwards. However, let us look here at the attacks on OA 178 and Portland Naval Base, carried out by the Stuka force on the 4th of July 1940. With long-range fighter cover provided by the Messerschmitt 110s of 5, the Stora Legerschwader 1, And Messerschmitt 109s of Two Staffen of 1 Jagdgeschaffe 1, redesignated as 3 Jagdgeschaffe 27 the following day, the Junkers 87 dive bombers of 3 Stuka Geschwader 51, also redesignated as 3 Stuka Geschwader 1 2 days later, struck Portland at shortly after 08:15, bombing the harbour, harbour installations, and the ships within it. 26 dive bombers took part in the raid, and one of the vessels hit was HMS Foilbank, an anti-aircraft ship converted from a pre-war freighter and stationed at Portland from the 9th of June 1940 to defend this important naval base against air attack. Mounted on the Foilbank were four twin 4-inch high-angle guns, multiple 2-pounder quick-firing pom-pom guns, and 0.5-inch caliber machine guns. The Stukas dived on Foilbank before the gun crews on board properly had time to react to the action station's alert, and unlike many of the Stukas' later shipping targets in the English Channel, she was, quite literally, a sitting duck, stationary and within the harbour. There was no question of this vessel being able to take avoiding action, or that the Stuka pilots needed to resolve sighting issues on a moving, twisting and turning target. In the onslaught, a good many bombs struck the foil bank with direct hits. 250-kilogram and 50-kilogram missiles all rained down in salvos of 4 at a time, 104 in total being dropped. Other bombs fell very close to foil bank, causing blast and splinter damage to the ship. One of them scored a direct hit and blew to matchwood the foil bank's own tender that had been tied up alongside. On board the anti-aircraft ship herself, it was sheer mayhem and carnage. One who was there described the ghastly scenes on deck as being like a cross between a butcher's shop and a scrap metal yard. In a few short minutes, no less than 176 Royal Navy sailors had been killed, and the foil bank was sent to the bottom of the harbour. In the moments before she finally succumbed to the German attack, some of the gunners had got to their stations and had begun to ready themselves to fire back at the Stukas. Such was the surprise of the attack, however, and so quickly was it all over, that only the ship's Y 4-inch gun was able to fire, managing to get off 27 rounds from the port barrel and 28 from the starboard. Meanwhile, leading seaman Jack Mantle was battling to get his set of pom-pom guns to bear. In their diving attacks, the Stuka pilots' usually adopted method was to dive as steeply as possible and sometimes at up to 90 degrees towards the stern of the ship. At around 1,500 feet, the angle was decreased to 45 degrees, and the pilot's Ravy gun sight was lined up on the target ship's stern as the pilot fired his twin forward 7.92mm MG-17 machine guns, mounted one in each wing. Gradually, the hail of bullets would move along the length of the ship, and when the pilot saw them striking the water ahead of the ship's bow, the bombs were released. In this way, the machine gun fire was an aid to sighting the bombs, and had the additional effect of keeping down the heads of any would-be defenders who might be firing back. In addition, the altimeter was set to local altitude above mean sea level, and when passing the set altitude for bomb release, a loud warning horn sounded to tell the pilot to press the bomb release and pull out of his dive. As the Stuka pulled out and drew away from the target, so the rear gunner would take over the machine gunning to maintain anti-aircraft fire suppression. So, when the Stukas dived on Foilbank, they were raking her with high explosives and bullets almost continuously for several minutes, and just at the moment that the gun crews were racing along exposed decks and gangways and up ladders to get to their stations. Some were lucky to escape, but many were cut down by machine gun bullets or flying shrapnel, or literally caught in bomb blasts from direct hits. Standing in his exposed gun position, Jack Mantle was having difficulty with the changeover lever on the top of the gun. Either through blast or gunfire, it had become slightly bent, although he had managed to get away some rounds. Already, Mantle had been hit and badly wounded in the leg, and was losing a great deal of blood. But instead of seeking the medical attention that he so clearly, desperately needed, he stayed at his post. Just as he had won his battle with the damaged lever, a further wave of attacking Stukas came in over the mole by Portland's South Ship Channel. As Jack Mantle opened fire, so too did the pilot of the diving Stuka, and in his attacking come sighting burst of gunfire, the hapless sailor fell across his gun, mortally wounded. He had been hit across the chest with machine gun bullets. Lifted gently down from his bullet and shrapnel-spattered station, and soaked in his own blood, Mantle was taken to Portland Hospital, where the 23-year-old seaman died later that same day. Of Mantle's action, the captain of HMS Foilbank, Captain H.P. Wilson, reported to the Commander-in-Chief Portsmouth, who, on receiving Wilson's report, was moved to record that Mantle had behaved too magnificently for words. It was magnificent behavior that, ultimately, would lead to the posthumous award of a Victoria Cross for leading seaman Jack Mantle. His citation was fulsome in its praise. Between his bursts of fire, he had time to reflect on the grievous injuries of which he was soon to die. But his great courage bore him up till the end of the fight, when he fell by the gun he had so valiantly served. Notwithstanding Jack Mantle's courage, nothing that might be called a wholly effective defence was put up by HMS Foilbank, purely because the ship was not at battle station readiness when the attack came, and the attack was completely without warning. Although she was an anti-aircraft ship, she had been sunk by air attack, the very type of attack against which she was designed to defend. Other defences that day were impotent too. During the attack on Portland, the Messerschmitt 110s and 109s had circled protectively overhead to ward off the anticipated interfering RAF fighters. However, there was absolutely no response from RAF Fighter Command, which had equally been taken by complete surprise. So much so that a solitary fairy battle of No. 10 Bombing and Gunnery School from RAF Warmwell had not been recalled, but instead found itself virtually caught up in the dive bombing attack on Portland. It was also the only RAF aircraft anywhere in the vicinity. Piloting the aircraft, K-9429, was Sergeant A.W. Kearsey, who was steadily approaching the practice bombing range at nearby Chesil Beach, when he noticed bombs falling off to his left at Portland with an angry swarm of bees above. He called to his two trainee aircrew in the rear cockpit to man the defensive Vickers K-gun before it dawned on him that they didn't have one. It had been taken out for airfield defense. Feeling somewhat vulnerable in such close proximity to a mass of Stukas, and with enemy fighters circling overhead, Kearsey beat a hasty and judicious retreat back to Warmwell. To quote Kearsey, "I was going downhill, balls out, and as fast as I could." Note: Sergeant Arthur W. Kearsey transferred to RAF Fighter Command during August 1940 and flew Spitfires with 152 Squadron for the remainder of the Battle of Britain. As smoke was still rising over Portland, a single Junkers 88 reconnaissance aircraft of 1F-123 set out to check on the progress of OA-178, and reporting the shipping now southwest of Portland, an immediate strike was ordered and carried out by 24 Junkers 87s of 1 Stuka Geschwader 2, flying from Falaise, with an escort of a single Staffel of 1 Jagdgeschaffer 1. Amongst the crews taking part in that attack were Rock, Teschel, and Witt, of 3 Stuka Geschwader 2, flying WNR-5129, T-6, and KL, in what would be their first combat flight against what Rock Teschel described as 12 ships. The pair would continue to fly as a crew in operations against British targets until they both died together during the attack on Tangmere on the 16th of August 1940. The attack by Stuka Geschwader 2 was followed very shortly afterwards by another, from the hastily rearmed and refueled 3 Stuka Geschwader 51, which sent out a further 23 Stukas. The ships of the convoy were now sailing perilously close to the French coast. The Isle of Wight had looked a very long way away when they had passed by, whilst further on in the journey, Cap La Hague, the Channel Islands, and the whole coast of France had seemed alarmingly near. Of course, the passage of OA-178 had not escaped the attention of the 1F-123 Junkers 88, and the Stuka strike was duly ordered, although in reality the closeness, or otherwise, to the French coast of the OA-178 convoy was not a significant factor in the attack being ordered. When the Stukas pounced, they hit the merchant vessels Dallas City, Flimston, Deucalion, and Antonio. Of these, Dallas City was badly damaged and on fire. Eventually she would sink, but not before colliding with Flimston, the two vessels being locked together by the collision for an agonizing 15 minutes. On board the Dallas City, her gunner gave more than a good account of himself as he stood his ground, firing resolutely at the diving Stukas as they in turn machine-gunned him. Meanwhile, Flimston and Antonio had managed to limp, both of them badly damaged, into the bomb-shattered wreckage that had been Portland Harbour, and where the foil bank was still sinking. Again, there had been no interference with the attack on OA-178 from RAF Fighter Command, although two Stukas, of seven Stuka Geschwader 51, had been lost during the attacks on Portland to anti-aircraft fire. Lieutenant Wilhelm Schwarzer and Unteroffizier Julius Dörflinger were killed when the Junkers 87B1 crashed into the English Channel south of Portland after its engine exploded, and the crew of another seven Staffel machine were rescued from the sea off the Contentin Peninsula. In addition, one Messerschmitt 109 of Jagdgeschwader 1 had returned damaged and crashed on landing at Deville, its pilot unhurt. Out in the channel, the convoy was now in disarray, and four of its ships had been lost. As nighttime approached, there was another danger: E-boats. From their home port of Boulogne, on the French coast, four motor torpedo boats of the 1S Flotilla put to sea and headed for the already battered OA-178, where, just before midnight, the SS Elmcrest was struck on the port side by a torpedo. The attack had come out of the dark of the night, and with complete surprise. Listing, and clearly in a sinking state, the crew of Elmcrest were ordered to abandon ship. As they did so, the E-boat came in to deliver a final blow and fired another torpedo into the starboard side. Unfortunately, this coincided with the moment that the lifeboat was pulling away from the stricken ship, and the torpedo passed directly under the boat, causing it to capsize and throwing all the survivors into the water. 16 men drowned. Moments later, another E-boat put two more torpedoes into the merchant ship SS British Corporal, and the crew abandoned what they believed to be a sinking vessel. Miraculously, she remained afloat and was later towed into harbour with two of her crew dead. The Hartlepool was also torpedoed and abandoned in what also seemed to be a sinking condition, although she too was salvaged and later beached at Weymouth. The nocturnal attackers had been S-19, S-20, S-24 and S-26, captained by Oberleutnant José Dörniges, Lieutenant José von Mierbach, Oberleutnant José Detlefsen and Oberleutnant José Fimmen, respectively. Also aboard the S-24 was Kapitänleutnant Birnbacher, the flotilla commander. Prime Minister Winston Churchill had been sufficiently alarmed by events in the English Channel on the 4th of July 1940 that he felt it necessary to issue an Action This Day memo to the Admiralty. "Could you let me know on one sheet of paper what arrangements you are making about the Channel convoys, now that the Germans are all along the French coast? The attacks on the convoy yesterday, both from the air and by E-boats, were very serious, and I should like to be assured this morning that the situation is in hand and that the air is contributing effectively." Of course, in respect of air involvement on the 4th of July 1940, there had not been any, effective or otherwise. The only RAF presence, and that only by accident, had been Arthur Casey's lumbering ferry battle. Whilst it was decided that the OA convoy should immediately be routed differently after the debacle and massacre of the 4th of July, it still remained the case that the CE and CW convoys needed to ply the English Channel. Clearly, it was imperative that, so far as was reasonably practicable, these Channel convoys should continue to run, but under protective cover of RAF fighter patrols, or any other defensive measures against air attack that could be usefully employed. Of the events on the 4th of July, Admiral Max Horton of the Royal Navy Northern Patrol was scathing, and called it a disgraceful episode. That said, it would have been difficult, if not impossible, to have provided standing fighter protection for the 12 ships of OA-178. Quite simply, she was too far out in the channel for patrols to have been mounted effectively, and once the attack was in progress, the attacking Stukas had it all their own way. Even if RAF fighters had been scrambled, the attackers would have been back at their home airfields before the defenders had arrived overhead the convoy. The failure to protect Portland was, however, just that. Whilst the earlier attacks on Channel shipping, not by Stukas, had illustrated the vulnerability of Channel traffic to bomber aircraft, the events of the 4th of July 1940 had been a clear demonstration of German military power in the English Channel, and the virtual inability of the Royal Navy and Royal Air Force, thus far, to do very much about it. The Stukas and E-boats had been demonstrated as a deadly force against the coasters and merchant ships running the Channel, and if lessons had been learned from the 4th of July, it would yet still be the case that further convoys would come under the same sort of punishing attacks, Stukas by day, E-boats by night. These elements of attacks on Channel convoys became commonly recurring themes. It is also a theme that has a rich vein running through it, the utterly magnificent courage of Royal Navy gunners, who were defending valiantly against air attack. Time and again, their heroism shines out of the dark story that was the saga of these convoy attacks. It was a special kind of bravery, and one epitomized by that of leading seaman Jack Mantle, VC. Courage during the Battle of Britain would not uniquely be the domain of RAF fighter pilots. Furthermore, the Stuka force had more than impressively flexed its collective muscle on the 4th of July and had forced the subsequent rerouting of OA convoys and a rethink on the protection of Channel convoys. It had also neutralized the key anti-aircraft defense at the Portland Naval Base, a key Royal Navy establishment. These had just been the first steps towards closing the English Channel. But there would yet be more Stuka attacks during July that would have a further significant impact on shipping and Royal Navy activity along these shipping lanes. And these were shipping lanes that were absolutely vital for Britain's survival, both in the context of defensive operations as well as commercially. Chapter 3. Fall of the Ironsides. To a very large extent, there was great reliance on the Messerschmitt 110 as the escort fighter that would shepherd the Junkers 87 on operations across the Channel and toward the coastal areas of Dorset, Hampshire and West Sussex. Really, there was no other choice. Quite simply, and as we shall see later, the endurance and range of the Messerschmitt 109 was not adequate for flying close protection missions to the lumbering Stukas at this, the widest point of the Channel. Thus, the losses to Messerschmitt 110s escorting Stukas back to Portland, just 1 week after the attack on Foyl Bank and OA 178, must have been a shock to the Luftwaffe aircrew, still brimful of confidence after the picnic that had been the attacks of the 4th of July. Those losses, on the 11th of July 1940, were significant for a number of reasons and are also inextricably linked to the Stuka story and its operations against Britain. The Luftwaffe fighter force of 1940 could, broadly speaking, be divided into two distinct elements, the Jagdverbände, fighter arm, and Zerstörerverbände, destroyer arm. Of these, the former comprised the Messerschmitt 109, single-engine and single-seat fighter, and the latter, the twin-engine, twin-seat, Messerschmitt 110 Zerstörer, destroyer. Of the Messerschmitt 110, it is fair to say that great store was placed in its prowess and virtual invincibility by the Luftwaffe chief, Hermann Göring. According to the Messerschmitt 110 ace, Wolfgang Falk, it was Göring who stated in 1938 that an elite force was being set up to spearhead the Luftwaffe, which would be a formidable offensive asset that Göring compared to Cromwell's Ironsides during the English Civil War. It was an analogy that would ultimately have a peculiar and eerie resonance, almost at the very first moment the Battle of Britain began. Essentially, and indeed specifically, the Messerschmitt 110 had operational specifications which largely set out its role during the Battle of Britain. To penetrate deep into enemy territory in order to clear the skies of enemy opposition ahead of bomber formations, escorting and providing close defense for bomber formations, the interception and destruction of enemy bomber formations, carrying out bombing and strike missions, as well as ground attack missions. Certainly, and with its concentrated package of firepower in the nose, comprising two 20mm cannon and four 7.92mm machine guns, the Zerstörer seemed to live up to its name, and it was indeed the case that any aircraft coming within its sights would be likely to receive a devastating fusillade of fire. The Messerschmitt's 110's apparently overwhelming superiority, however, was to be short-lived when ultimately pitted against faster and more agile single-seater fighters. Nevertheless, in the prelude to war, it seemed to Göring that here was a wonder weapon to which the very cream of Luftwaffe fighter pilots would be assigned. It was, perhaps, a combination of that perceived elite status and a certain degree of family influence that saw Hermann Göring's nephew, Hans Joachim Göring, posted to the Zerstörerverbande. By the end of June 1940, he was serving as a pilot with 9 Zerstörer Geschwader 76 on the Channel coast, holding the rank of Oberleutnant. Once or twice, Hans Joachim had flown off on special leave to visit his famous uncle, and had returned to Zerstörer Geschwader 76 with fine cigars and cognac for the Geschwader aircrews, gifts from the Reichsmarschall himself. Once, on return to his unit, he had stressed to fellow pilots that Uncle Hermann had placed great trust in the Ironsides to protect the Stukas. Longer term, it proved to be a hopelessly misplaced trust. And yet, in the shorter term, Hans Joachim and his fellow pilots would certainly give their all in protection of the Stuka force. In the wake of the 4th of July 1940 debacle, the RAF and other defending forces were anxious not to be caught napping.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.